left oriented corner. And this is NL. NL, because the corner is unoriented. Oriented, and it's the left unoriented corner. Because the corner is unoriented, and it's the left oriented, and it's the left unoriented corner. Two or three letters indicate one of the 12 specific ZBLL cases. ZBLL cases. For example, ZBLL cases. For example, AO. For example, AO means the case where these two are adjacent and these two are opposite. Two are adjacent. CXO means that these two are adjacent, and these two are opposite.
Why is it taking so long? It shouldn't take that long. Thanks for losing my place again. Gosh dang it. It takes forever for me to find it. And it took me like 20 seconds. Still. Stop.
Ready, set, internet. Extreme internet starts at $19.99 a month for a year. Get speeds from 6.
Authorities have made mistakes in the past. They will do so again in the future. Perhaps a better way to say it is that in science, there are no authorities. At most, there are experts. And these expert scientists, by the way, don't sit around making up silly stories and unsupported assertions and distortions of evolution like this creature saying that there has to be an unusable stage of half wings and half legs for evolution to be true. Scientists don't go asking any old rando for their uneducated opinion like this preacher who says that scientists say we came from rocks, even though no scientist ever said that. There's a lot more research that is peer-reviewed for factual errors that can possibly fit into a flippant one-liner. So they don't ask Joe Blow for a correction, nor do they encourage belief, either. The scientists challenge each other's hypotheses, and whatever isn't supported doesn't warrant serious consideration. Spin more than one hypothesis. If there's something to be explained, think of all the different ways in which that could be explained. Then think of tests, which might systematically disprove each of those alternatives. What survives, the hypothesis that resists disproof in this Darwinian selection among multiple working hypotheses, has a much better chance of being the right answer than if you had simply run with the first idea that caught your fancy. Try not to get overly attached to a hypothesis just because it's yours. It's only a way station in the pursuit of knowledge. Ask yourself why you like the idea. Compare it fairly with the alternatives to see if you can find reasons for rejecting it. If you don't, others will. And this is a problem that affects jury trials. Retrospective studies show that some jurors make up their minds very early, perhaps during opening arguments, and then retain the evidence that seems to support their initial impression, while rejecting all the contrary evidence. And the method of comparing and analyzing alternative working hypotheses is not working in their heads. Quantify if whatever it is that you're explaining has some measure, some numeric quantity attached to it. You'll be much better able to discriminate among competing hypotheses. What is vague and qualitative is open to many explanations. Of course, there are truths to be sought in the many qualitative issues we are obliged to confront, but finding them is more challenging. If there's a chain of argument, every link in the chain must work, including the premise, not just most of them. Occam's razor. This convenient rule of thumb urges us, when faced with two hypotheses that explain the data equally well, to choose the simpler. I would also add that we can employ Hitchens' razor as well, that while positive claims require positive evidence, just as Sagan said, Hitchens added that what is asserted without evidence may be dismissed without evidence. And finally, always ask whether the hypothesis can be, at least in principle, falsified. Because there should be some way to tell if it's wrong, if it is, right? You'd want to know that, right? I mean, why would you want to believe something that might not even be true? Only accurate information has practical application. So if a proposition cannot be indicated or vindicated, verified or falsified, such that there's no way to know whether it's right or wrong or what's wrong with it and which direction would lead to correction, then it's worthless. The only value information can have is however accurate it can be shown to be. And if you can't show that it's accurate at all, then it has no value at all. It is not only empty speculation, but pointless as well. And that's the problem with every religious sermon I've ever heard.
We covered more on that in one of the debates I did. I forget which one, but...
I know we covered this back when the preacher debated me.
And then you said, it is a fact that birds are a subset of dinosaurs. Obviously, this is similar to a bird. Who can't see the difference?
One problem with creationists is your perspective has no depth. Let me explain this to you one last time. It's really not that hard. Remembering that evolution is all about biodiversity. The Phylogeny Explorer has logged some 1,440 dinosaur species. There are a few subclades within the dinosaur clade, one of them being sauropods, like the toy you were just showing. Another being theropods, which are bipedal, like birds. It was along this lineage that traces of pycnofibers developed into downy feathers and eventually double-veined feathers like modern birds have. And what we see of their evolutionary development of the fossil record matches their embryological development in modern birds. As we examine each of the species in this lineage, we see a definite series of transitions to increasingly bird-like dinosaurs until they are indistinguishable from birds, until the dinosaurs become birds. But none of these birds ever stopped being dinosaurs.
There's an article about this, DarwinismRefuted.com. I don't know anything about them, but I enjoyed what I read. Are birds and dinosaurs related? They go through a whole list of things showing, no, they cannot possibly be related for all sorts of reasons. Their heart is completely different. Their lung structure is completely different. They're reproductive. Don't reptiles and birds have a hard calcium-covered egg shell? Reptiles have a leathery type of egg. How did it go... in the difference there?
The reptile family tree has a deep fork between two main branches. The only reptiles to have a leathery shell are lizards and snakes, which were a subset of lizards. And they're on the lepidosaur side of the reptile family tree. And they have three-chambered hearts. Turtles are older and more toward the middle of the fork between lepidosaurs and archosaurs. They have 3.5-chambered hearts, as well as hard-shelled eggs. Dinosaurs, crocodilians, and birds are all in the archosaur side of the reptile family tree, and they all have hard calcium-covered eggs and four-chambered hearts. Dinosaurs and birds are both warm-blooded and covered in feathers. They have the same type egg, the same type heart, and the same type of respiration. Dinosaurs and birds share a unique system of air sacs connected to hollow pneumatic skeletons that some of them could actually breathe through. And this extremely efficient system allows for a continuous flow of oxygen rather than the hepatic piston method of breathing that crocodiles use. There is no more diagnostic feature than this unique system of air sacs that birds obviously inherited from dinosaurs. Remember when you thought that lizards grew up to be dinosaurs even though they're cold-blooded, naked, and only have three-chambered hearts? Are you embarrassed by that yet?
Don't reptiles have a separate passage for the baby to be born from the urinary tract, where birds have all one? Just one hole does it all for a bird. That's where they go number one, number two, and have babies, all same place. Go check it out. How did it make that transition between that one and the other?
Birds are technically reptiles, and as such, they use the same cloaca as all other reptiles do, and monotremes too. The only animals with separated anus, vagina, and urinary tract are mammals of the clade Theria. All other fossil mammals apparently had a cloaca too, just like the platypus and echidna still do.
Don't whales have a separate hole for breathing than eating, and they can eat and breathe at the same time? They're not connected. From that hole in the top of their head goes to...
Okay, so... All right. Where did I save the video to? Oh no, I probably saved to the wrong place. Oh, here it is. It saves to the desktop, so at least it's not that bad. I want it to be in here.
Solving the Rubik's Cube. I chose to do a method of improvement that was not the most efficient option, but rather it was the option that had the most interesting things to talk about it, and therefore was easier to make a video about. That's what happens when you place more importance on making YouTube videos than on actually getting better at cubing. Anyways, I spent a week trying to master 12 ZBLL algorithms. ZBLL is a set of algorithms that allow you to solve both ORL and PLL in one algorithm, if you have an ORL case with all the edges for you. Full ZBLL consists of 472 algorithms. This video is going to demonstrate how difficult it is to master just 12 ZBLL algs, let alone 472. Or maybe I'm just dumb. First, I had to choose which ZBLLs to learn. ZBLL is divided into 7 different groups. One for each of these ZBLL is divided into 7 different groups. One for each of these 7 ORL cases. It is further divided into 6 groups per OLL, one for each of the COLL cases, or one for each way the corners can be permuted for each case. Each COLL case has 12 different ZBLL cases, one for each way that the edges are permuted. I chose to learn the ZBLL U3 cases, or every ZBLL that has this COLL case, where these two stickers are the same color, and these two are the same. I chose this because this is the worst COLL that I actually use, and I'm trying to, in a sense, raise the floor by learning ZBLL for this case. The next step was to go through the algorithms for all 12 cases and choose which one I wanted to learn. I went to speedcubedb.com and looked at the 4 most popular algs for each case and chose which ones I would prefer to learn based on how easily and quickly I could execute them. I put the algorithms I chose into this document. Finally, it was time to start learning the algorithm. Throughout this whole process, I used a website called TrainU, which allows you to input specific algorithms to practice. The way I memorized them was, I would memorize 2 algorithms and then put them into the trainer and practice them for a while. Then I would memorize 2 more algs, practice them, and then practice all 4 algorithms, and that continued until I had memorized all 12 of the algs. It took me 2 days to learn all 12 algorithms. The method I used for recognizing each case is to look at these 4 stickers and the relation between them. I look at the relationship between these 2 stickers and between these 2 stickers. They can either be... same color, opposite means they are colors on opposite sides of the cube, and adjacent means they are colors on adjacent sides of the cube. Additionally, I have to distinguish between 3 cases where both these 2 and these 2 are adjacent. For these cases, I also have to look at the relationship between these 2 stickers and these 2 stickers. So it took me 2 days to memorize all 12 algs, and then on day 3, I just continued practicing them. At this point, I was only recognizing the cases from this specific AUF. AUF stands for adjust upper face. So, for example, if I got the case from this position, I would adjust the upper face to this position instead so I could recognize the case. My ultimate goal, however, was to recognize the cases from every possible AUF. So that is what I worked on. My ultimate goal, however, was to recognize the cases from every possible AUF. So that is what I worked on for the rest of the week. This is very difficult, because this essentially means that for every case, you have to memorize 4 different ways of recognizing that case. 12 cases, 4 AUFs for each one. That makes a total of 48 different things that you have to memorize, and I determined a way of memorizing them, but I now realize it wasn't the most efficient way to do so. So everything I'm about to tell you about how I memorize this stuff, I would not recommend you use this method. I will explain why later. Anyways, what I did was identify all 48 cases by a series of letters. The first two letters indicate the AUF. Y for yes, as in the corner is oriented, or N for no, the corner isn't oriented, and R, the right corner, or L, the left corner. So this is YL, because the corner is oriented, and we are looking at the left-oriented corner. And this is NL, because the corner is unoriented, and it's the left-unoriented corner. The next two or three letters indicate one of the 12 specific ZBLL cases. For example, AO means the case where these two are adjacent and these two are opposite. I'm trying to get better at solving a Rubik's Cube.
Okay. I did way too many.
Stickers and these two stickers. So it took me 2 days to memorize all 12 ALs. So that is what I worked on for the rest of the week. This is very difficult. And I determined a way of memorizing them that I now realize wasn't. Anyways, what I did. And it's the left unoriented corner. The next two or three letters indicate one of the two, because the corner is unoriented, and it's the left unoriented corner. The next means that these two are correct, and these two are correct. So, means the case where these two are adjacent, and these two are opposite. Hi, I'm trying to get better at solving it.
CXO.
CXO means that these two are correct, and these two are correct, and these two are opposite. So now. NRCA is this case right here. NRCA. Thank you. match every case with just to match every these cases just to match every case with case. The way I decided to normalize these cases. This case, and you switch to the AUF I originally memorized it from. It changes to AC. AC. Here I have to explain that I didn't read every case after these letters. In this case, I actually named it far right. Far right, because it's a bar on the right. For all the cases where there's a bar, I had to memorize this phrase. NRCA is bar right. This case. NLAO is OXO. This AUF, 12 for this one, and 12 for this one, the total. phrases that I had to memorize. Phrases that, again, I don't recommend doing it this way. Not this way. But what I did was just sort of twist it. I just used the Quizlet app to continue reviewing all the stuff I had memorized. Then eventually I tried doing a session of practice solves where I could. Thank you. Since I can't mix that for many of these cases, pull Q, but you might have to do a final turn of the upper face. And since I can't mix that for many of these cases, I have to pause and see what the final turn is after doing now. For many of the cases, I have to translate what I'm seeing into a series of letters. This is what I'm ultimately working towards anyways. So I may as well just directly do this. Instead of including unnecessary intermediate step by memorizing specific letters. To do this, but at least that makes a bit of progress in the I don't want all this work to go to waste. So at least that made some progress. I don't want all this work to go to waste. So goodbye. Goodbye.
And you can go to the next
To re-record every single video I just made because I did not with yellow top. Red and orange.
Which one is the bathroom? First door? There we go. Okay.
Thank you.
Oh, wow. I just realized I was recording the whole time. I meant to do that, but I totally forgot I was doing that.